Blog Talk Radio. Happy Tuesday, everybody. Welcome to the My Rays of Light show. I'm your host, L.M. Young. Tonight, we're going to be talking with author Joyce Graham about her new project, The Healing the Heart of a Warrior, which is a book that's coming out in the fall. Joyce started writing poetry in high school and has had a lifelong desire to continue her writing to help others in the area of health and wellness. A college instructor for 7 years and the recent radio talk show host in Loveland and in Denver. She interviewed both local and national leaders in health and wellness. She was a military counselor for 4 years, and she worked with our returning soldiers and airmen coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan. Joyce, welcome to the show tonight.
It's a pleasure to be here.
So, I mean, as soon as I had read about you, I thought, you know, she's exactly what I want to have on the show, you know, because we're constantly talking about how to inwardly, spiritually, inside of us, trying to heal ourselves. Because, as you know, if you have weight down on your soul, something's weighing on you, it's very difficult for you to heal, even physically. I'm really still thankful that you agreed to be on the show tonight, because I know that you have a lot of really important, vital information that you can share with us.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that you extended the invitation, and I'm happy to be here. It's really a lifelong desire to be of service and to share the knowledge that I have and that I've gained, and to try to just spread that and let people know there's a lot of wonderful, wonderful tools that we have available to us for healing. And so it's a pleasure to be here. I love radio, and I had my own show for a while, but now I've kind of committed to the writing path. So, again, I know you're an author as well. So it's always a pleasure to be with like-minded people.
Exactly. I agree. I agree completely. Why don't you tell our audience a little bit more about you and your, you know, your schooling and all the things that you've done?
Well, you know, it was interesting. I knew at age 9, I had a friend that I was actually helping who had cerebral palsy. And she was very dear to me, and I just knew working with her and helping her, and then also a couple of other things that happened at a very young age that drew me to know that I wanted to be in the healing and the helping professions. And of course, sometimes we don't listen until, you know, it really knocks on the door. I decided after high school that I wanted to work for a couple years, and I did that. I worked, and then I went back and became a respiratory therapist, which really was a blessing. My father developed emphysema, and I was able to take care of him for many years. He was in really good shape because he knew how to take care of himself and at home. So that was a really wonderful gift to give to my father to be able to help him. And then after I left respiratory therapy, I was pre-med, and I was either going to go into ministry, medicine, or go into psychology. Mm-hmm. And I decided on psychology, and so that's been my path. Then I added homeopathy when I moved from Missouri, Kansas City, was my hometown, to Denver. I was either going to go into naturopathy school, or I was going to be either do homeopathy, and I found a school in Boulder for homeopathy and graduated in the 90s. At the same time, I became a Reiki master and was teaching Reiki, and then met some Chinese Qigong masters here that came to Denver that were from China, and started learning Qigong. And so I'm also a certified Qigong instructor. So All that to say, I just think healing has been my life. And, you know, I think it's just been a wonderful path to be of service. And, of course, I have a lot of fun on the side, too. It's not just all work. But, yeah, I really enjoy it.
It sounds like it. I mean, it's very worthwhile work. You know, and I agree with you. Whenever you are in service for others, for myself personally, when I'm in service for others, my life seems to open up. You know, it's I have lupus, and when I know that whenever I'm doing things for other people, it doesn't quite affect me the way it does whenever I'm not. You know, it opens you up to. I guess it's just a loving energy, because whenever you're giving out, you're always going to get back, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very worthwhile thing to do. I'm always encouraging people to do that, you know, give back in any way that you're able to give back, because it always comes rushing back to you.
I couldn't agree more. Mm-hmm. No, I totally agree. That's a great statement. It comes back to you tenfold. And I think a lot of people know that. Some people aren't called to, but I think they do it in different ways. Like my banker, he does a great job, and I go in and I talk to him about different things at my credit union, and he's wonderful to talk to. And his calling is serving in a way that helps people with money. So I'm a firm believer whatever it is that you do really well, you're serving, whether it's in the healing realm or it's in banking, or a fireman. Certainly firemen are very much a part of and helping people. So, yeah. And then I just wanted to get back to the military. My dad was in World War II. He was called up in his late 30s to serve in World War II. And so I had older parents. But he always talked about it in such a way that was so proud that he was American, that he served, and for 4 years. And back then, you know, they didn't have email and Facebook, and they couldn't do a lot of things. So, you know, he didn't get to see my mom very often during those 4 years. But so that's when I decided, after 9/11, I tried to join the military, but I was past the age limit. And I was trying to find a way to actually help them. And a friend of mine told me about a position with a company. So I worked with the military. I'm a licensed professional counselor, which is an LPC, and I'm a graduate. I have my master's degree in counseling from the University of Kansas. So, and I've actually been doing it for 25 years. This is my 25th year. And, you know, I just wanted to give them something that's another tool. So that's what this next book is about.
It sounds great. I mean, I really want to know a lot about the book. I know it's coming out. You're going to release it in the fall, correct? But you're going to do a pre-release in the summer?
I'm going to do like pre-release. People have been asking when they could buy a copy. And I'm going to pre-sell it probably this summer. I am self-publishing. This is my third book, and I'm going to officially release it in September, but I'll probably start, pre-selling it probably June, maybe June or July, so you can look forward to it. And I'll post it on my website, which is my name, joycegraham.com. So it's pretty exciting. There's so many things that they don't know. And that was frustrating to me. And I'm always a person that likes to find the answers, because I have a scientific mind, as well as, you know, wanting to find the right thing for the person that comes to you for help. So, you know, I saw a lot of things that they weren't doing And I thought, gosh, you know, I just really felt called to write this book. So I'm really excited about it. You know, I know you're a writer. Don't you get excited when you're writing something? Doesn't it just, like, it kind of grabs you and you're like, oh,
you know,
I really want to do this.
Well, you know, whenever I'm doing the writing, I also write on WordPress, and that's where I started the writing. And the most exciting part to me is whenever I've written something and it touches someone, or someone will say, you are talking directly to me. I really needed to hear that today. You know, people that you would have no idea what's going on in their lives, you know. And so whenever you write something and it touches someone in a way to where they feel like they want to reach out to you, that is the most exciting thing. It's encouraging because it makes you want to write more. You know, because you always, well, for myself, I always want to make a difference. I always want to be encouraging that even in the darkest storms, you know, the light exists, you know. And so whenever I have people contacting me about the writing and the books, the poetry, it always makes me feel really good to know that I was able to help at least, even if it's only one person. You know, the purpose of doing what we do is to reach out. And if you only reach one person, it's one person more that would have been reached, you would have touched. You know, had you not written it, that wouldn't have happened. So I can understand completely about this. I'm so excited about Healing the Heart of a Warrior because I know that whenever a lot of soldiers come back, they come back changed because the things they have to endure there or they have to go through, you know. And I think that it's really important that we reach out to our armed service men and women, you know, because I know that a lot of the issue happens is people will come back and they will say, well, you're not the same, you know, you're not the same person that you were, not realizing that, or maybe they don't not take into consideration what they were called to do there, you know, and it may not be the same personality that it was when they left. How exactly do you go about reaching the servicemen and women when they come back in that way?
Well, you know, it really depends on the person. When I was traveling, I traveled to different military bases. I was with a company that sent me to different places, Germany, Korea, Fort Campbell, Fort Hood, bases, all the bases down in Colorado Springs. We have five bases, and I worked at all of them, and then I worked in Hawaii, and I have family there, so it was really fun to be able to be in Hawaii and see my niece have her first baby, so I have a great niece now. And they have a lot of military on there. People don't know that. A lot of people don't in Oahu, where Waikiki and Honolulu are. So I was able to work there. And, you know, everybody's different. You know, some people come back and they have issues with relationships. So I did a lot of marriage counseling. We did a lot of reintegration where we worked with them when they've only been back for, you know, a very short period of time, less than a week, and talking to them about, you know, what they heard, what they saw, and the beauty, and I wanted to share this, the beauty of my position was phenomenal. There were no records kept. So here I'm a counselor, and, you know, deal mostly with, and I'm very holistic, but my job was to, you know, do counseling and use my skills in that way, but we didn't keep any records. So anybody who talked to us, which is a huge benefit, anybody who talked to me in my position nothing was reported, and that's huge in the military because they don't want any records, nothing on there that's, well, I had this problem or that problem. Because it causes an issue with their service, obviously. So that was a beauty. And, you know, I think that everybody experiences war and trauma and pain differently. And so some people choose substances. Some people choose to step out of their marriage or their relationship, you know, and be with somebody else. Everybody acts and handles it differently. And so people come back and they're okay. They reintegrate. They do fine. It's not everyone that has a problem when they come back. But certainly there are a few that very definitely have been traumatized. And so those are the people that we want to help if we want to, you know, get them to the right people that can heal them. And you and I both know that there's many different paths to healing. You know, I'm also a homeopath. I went to a homeopathy school. So there's homeopathy, there's herbal remedies, there's energy healing, there's qigong, there's massage. So there's several different modalities that can be used to help. And one of the big ones that has been used with the Army is therapeutic horsemanship. And that is just vital. I mean, and they use it with kids, too. If you have an autistic child or Asperger's, then children just love to be on a horse, and it is very healing. So they do a lot of work with men and women that come back with PTSD, and they use horse therapy, and it's remarkable some of the things that can happen.
Well, I think that, and that's really a great thing to do, because I think that, like with horses, like with, I've seen that with children in the pools with dolphins,
yeah,
in the waters with dolphins, anytime that you can be one with nature in that way, it creates a healing inside of you. It sort of, like I said, it opens you up, and whenever
yes.
whenever your core is opened up like that, this healing energy happens. Even if it's not a physical healing that happens, if it's a spiritual or a, you know, an inner healing that happens, it it creates joy in you. And I think that whenever you are able, whenever you are open to joy, there is literally nothing that can really stop you. You know, my personal belief on that is just that whenever you open up that way, joy comes rushing into you.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see children, horses is a great example, because when you see children around horses, all they're doing is laughing and smiling.
Uh-huh.
You know, and they're magnificent creatures, you know. That's a great therapy to have. That's a really great therapy.
And, you know, they're also using, there's guitars for vets. That's
mm-hmm.
a new program where people give guitars, and there's been a lot of guitars donated. And so vibrational healing or sound healing and using a guitar for people who are drawn to play guitars, that's also another great avenue. And having a dog, you know, a lot of times getting a dog for someone who's been traumatized, or a pet, there's been many studies that have shown that animals, as well as many other things, but animals can be great healers. So you can bring a pet into the home, and it's just a wonderful healing modality to have that little animal that is just there with unconditional love. And, you know, I have a pet, and I just, you know, I adore having a pet. It's just a wonderful feeling. So, yeah, thank you for saying that about horses. I personally love horses myself. I don't ride very often, but I used to when I was a teenager. And but I think that being around horses and the smell and being outside, and I love doing qigong and energy work outside. And then, of course, I live in one of the most beautiful states of the country, you know, over in the West, in Colorado. It's just beautiful here. So I like to get out and be in nature as much as I can. It just really revitalizes your soul.
I think so, too. I think, like I said, it's like becoming one with nature. Even if you are only taking a walk, even if you're only just taking a walk in the woods along a path or something like that, it reconnects you to the earth, you know, and whenever that happens, like I said, you get to watch and experience amazing things, you know, things that sometimes we're too busy in our day to notice. You know, when you take time out of your day to just to slow it down, to just slow, even your breathing pattern slows. You know, you become more relaxed. You become more relaxed in that way, you become more aware of everything around you. And you realize that the true beauty around us, you know, is magnificent. And it can be a great healing property because, like I said, I think that daily we just pile stuff up on top of us without even realizing that we're doing it. We're collecting the energy of everything around us. And after a while, it can weigh you down. And you can even think, at the end of the day, I don't know why I feel so tired. Why am I so tired? Not realizing because you're carrying around the weight of the entire day. You know, and unless you have a way or a method to release that, it can be exhausting.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that the work that you do is absolutely magnificent. I really do.
Well, thank you, dear. I really appreciate that compliment. That's very, very kind of you. And I want to say you can shake a really easy thing to do with Qigong or, you know, some people don't know what Qigong is. It's actually the parent of Tai Chi. It was the forerunner, and Tai Chi sprang from Qigong. And, of course, it's from China. But one of the things you can do is just shake your hands. Come home, and I teach people, shake your feet, shake, just shake. And sometimes if you do a yoga class, they do kind of an energy release where they shake. I've been in a class like that for yoga.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a very much an energy release. When you shake or when you do some things, when you come home, you literally shed that energy. And
wow.
Then you probably know the technique of visualization. You can visualize that energy just leaving you and send it up. I always like to send it up to the universe and imagine it being taken off of me and then transformed into something that's beautiful, like a beautiful color. And so I teach my students, you know, imagine that energy just becoming like a little pink or blue ball, like leaving you and going up and out of your body. And but you can get rid of it. You know, you don't have to carry that. And I think there are many things that we can talk about, and I'm so glad you brought that up, to release and let go. And I think that the trauma, when people are affected by war or any traumas in life, the healing process is really about awareness and being mindful. Like you talked about how we carry it, and being aware of when you've got too much on your shoulders, and then take a break. You know, Wayne Dyer talks a lot about that, and I admire him greatly. He's written some incredible books. And so you don't have to carry that. You can take a break, clear your plate, you know, take a long weekend, go on that road trip. You know, you don't have to work an extra day to make more money. Your life and your quality of life is so much more important if you take a night off, don't spend, you know, 3 hours in the evening on the computer every night of the week. It's important to give your mind a break. In fact, a lot of people don't realize this, but if you, studies have shown that if you stay on the computer, say until 10 o'clock, and then you go get ready for bed, you get in bed, your mind doesn't really slow down. It takes an hour and a half for your mind to slow down after you get off a computer.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of insomnia happens and sleepless and restlessness because your mind is still like going. It's like still on that computer. So if you go to bed at 10, you need to be off your computer by 9.
That's interesting.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? And
mm-hmm.
there's some techniques too if you sit in front of your computer a lot. I know a lot of people write on a computer. I tend to write longhand and then I transpose onto my computer when I'm ready to put it and then print it out. But I like to write longhand in a notebook. It feels more organic to me. So I would say 95% of the time I'm writing with a pen. And I kind of like it more. I can get better awareness about what I want to say. How about you? Do you do that?
I write on the computer a lot because I have lupus. It's difficult for me to write things out by hand a lot.
So
I use the computer a lot, but what I do notice is that, again, like I said, this is just for me, though, whenever I'm online, for instance, Facebook or Twitter, because I spend a lot of time in those venues, you can take on a lot of the energy that other people are, you know, even in their writing, what they're saying, you know, no matter what they're talking about. And I mean, if you ever spend any time on Facebook, a lot of people do spend a lot of time, you know, talking about their day, how bad it was, how good it was, and not realizing that whenever you're reading that, you are also taking in that energy. You know, so you're right about that, because at the end of the day, I'm still thinking about what this person or that person was going through or talking about, and it's constantly working in your mind. Even if you think you're trying to rest, my mind is always working. It's always moving. You know, so it is a it's true that happens specifically on Facebook, not quite as much on Twitter, because you're limited as to how you respond to each other because of the limit of characters you can use on Twitter as opposed to Facebook. But online in general, you know, you can take on the weight of the world literally, because the internet has you. It's you can anywhere. You can go anywhere. You can be anywhere you want to be, even if it's in your own mind. You know, because I had found that when I was reading about incidences that were happening, murders or suicides, things like that, my day would be much harder. It'd be much harder. You know, it would be really, really difficult. And my husband would actually say to me, "Okay, there's this article out. I don't think you should read it. I don't think you should read it." And I learned to really listen to him, because he knew if I read this, it's probably going to mess up my entire day, because it's going to affect me so deeply. You know, so that's very true. I think that I write better on when I'm typing than when I'm writing, because the difficulty happens off and on whenever I'm doing things long-handed. But
sure.
It's still, you know, I agree with you on that. I agree with you on that, because I'm an insomniac. I have difficulty sleeping, but I do spend a lot of time on the computer.
You know, my second book, The Path, Herbs, Homeopathy, and Holistic Healing, I write about homeopathy. And then Brigitte Mars, who's a very well-known herbalist, she's in Boulder, Colorado, she wrote the chapter on herbs. And so six different people from different different modalities. There's a aromatherapy. She writes on essential oils. And there's a Chinese medicine doctor who's in Colorado Springs, very knowledgeable man, Dr. Randall Wing. And he wrote a chapter on Chinese medicine. But I was going to say to you, there are many things that you can try that can help. And when we're off the air, I'll give you some suggestions. One of them is just what I said. Get off the computer. If you're going to go to bed at, say, 10 or 11, then be sure you're off, like, by 9, an hour to an hour and a half before you actually want to go to bed. And then learn to do something else. Like, you know, we all get drawn in, especially the Olympics are on. I love the Olympics. And I was just watching it. Before we called in and we were doing the show, I was watching the snowboarders, and a couple of them are from Breckenridge, which is right up the hill from me. And I love to ski Breckenridge, and I don't downhill anymore. I only do cross country and snowshoes. But, you know, I was watching that. I was, wow, this is so beautiful. And but we love to watch TV, and that's another thing. You should stop watching TV. I almost never watch the 10 o'clock news, because every story is who got shot, who got murdered, and where the most difficult situation happened in your hometown during that day. And if you put that in your mind before you go to sleep, you know, your mind is working it over. And so I always tell my clients, and I always recommend, you know, calm yourself down. I like to read, I'm a fan of National Geographic. I love reading that. Mm-hmm. And then I'll pick up something that's light reading. Like I do have a book by, what's his first name? And I just love him. Mark Nepo. I love his book. And it's full of beautiful, beautiful meditations and And so there's many different, whatever your spiritual practice is, you can choose someone in that, whether it's Joyce Meyer, Mark Nepo, or Native American, or Christian, you can choose something that calms you down and brings you into that place before you go to bed. And I right. think that is the most important thing. So I would, that's another thing that I recommend to people, especially people that have trouble sleeping. And then, of course, chamomile tea. That's always a good one.
That's true. That's true. That's really good. So we're going to take a break, and we'll be back in just a moment with Joyce Graham.
Took my hand, you showed me how, you promised me you'd be around, that's right. I took your words and I believed in everything you said to me, yeah, that's right.
By being an employee or self-employed. Heroes Academy helps break these chains that bind them. Our financial school has two courses of study. First, one for people who want to transition to become business owners, and the second for students who want to learn to become an investor. For more information, please go to heroacad.com.
Incarceration doesn't just affect the one behind bars. It affects everyone. Here's your chance to let others know that being locked up leaves others locked down on the outside, hurting emotionally, economically, and spiritually. We want to know how you feel. Go to www.lovelockdownseries.com and make your creative voice heard. Lovelockdownseries.com. We are listening.
Welcome back to the My Rays of Light show. I'm your host, L.M. Young. Tonight I'm sitting down and talking to author Joyce Graham. We're talking about her newest project, and it's, we were talking earlier about healing, not only on the physical sense, but in the spiritual sense, emotionally, spiritually, physically, and how they all can blend together. Joyce, what was your inspiration for writing your most recent book?
Well, I guess at my first base, I was at Fort Hood in 2009, and that's where I went out to start traveling and going to different bases as a counselor. And they're actually doing they actually started a wonderful project there, and the commander asked me to come back and teach Qigong. And I said, she said, you teach Qigong? And I said, yes. And they were doing acupuncture, they were doing meditation, they were doing all kinds of innovative, groundbreaking biofeedback. They were taking people that had severe PTSD and trauma and helping them with innovative ways. And so I was like really encouraged. And she said, come back and teach. And I said, well, I would love to do that for you, but I live in Denver, and so it's kind of a long commute, you know. And so that was kind of, you know, that was in a way very, very beautiful to get asked to do that. And so from the very beginning, I'm a holistic counselor, but I was in a position where I couldn't use that tool. But I was there to help, and the only thing I really would offer is, you know, the horse therapy. And it wasn't appropriate for me to offer all the things I know because it wasn't the environment. So I was constantly frustrated. I was like, I know how this person can get better, but they don't have the outlet. They don't know the knowledge. They don't have – and, you know, I am a firm believer that people have to know, or they have to read about it, or somebody has to tell them. And women, as women, we do it a lot. We say, oh, you know, I did this and this really helped me, whether it's our hair color or massage therapy or facials or any type of healing or even cooking. We share that as women. And so I was thinking, wow, you know, this is not being shared. And I am a firm believer, and I taught college for 7 years, that knowledge is one of the most important things. And I'm a book lover. I've always loved books. And I knew at a young age that I would be a writer when I was a little bit older. And so I just said, you know, something has to be different here. And I am a firm believer that it's a calling. When I write because it's from my heart and it's from what I know that I need to share, to serve, to help, because it's my profession and it's what I do. So I started writing this book before I left, you know, traveling. I quit traveling a little over a year ago and decided I wanted to, you know, put down some roots, and it got a little bit old living out of a suitcase and going a different place every 3 months. Even though I love Hawaii, I have to tell you, I do. I miss the water. But I love being in my home state of Denver, and I do consultations and I do counseling here, and I teach some Qigong. So I just said, you know, I have to sit down and do this. And I myself, I had a really bad car accident in September, right over Labor Day weekend. I had a very bad, and I had PTSD for 2 weeks. I was in really bad shape after the accident. I started experiencing, and I had not experienced PTSD before, but I had terrible problems with sleeping and crying and the emotions and not knowing what day it was. And I had a really great doctor and a chiropractor and a massage therapist and a homeopath and friends that came to my aid. And I said, well, this is part of my book, so I know firsthand what it's like to experience it and to recover from it. So I've done a lot of my own healing work, and so that was the inspiration. It's like, these people need help. And my book that I'm writing is very different I've read quite a few things that are out there, and they're very much like a textbook. And my book will not be like a textbook. It will be a self-help, and there'll be many tools in there. There'll be a toolbox in there, and you can go, oh, well, you know, this is something that might work for me. And of course, everybody needs to be aware that whatever you do and you try, you need to make sure that it's for you. And you,
right.
Some people will need to see a licensed person, a licensed medical professional. And I will put that disclaimer there. But I think that the knowledge is there, and it's integrative complementary medicine. Many people now use homeopathy. Dr. Oz talks about homeopathy. He talks
mm-hmm.
about all different kinds of things that we can use, like, you know, vinegar, apple cider vinegar for an upset stomach. He talks about aloe and using aloe. And he talks about using diet to control your mood swings. So all of those things are hugely important to me. And I have helped my clients recover and regain their life. You know, food is medicine. Everything you put in your mouth is either going to be for your body, or it's not great. Do you know what I mean? I think you're a proponent of that as well.
Yes, I mean, what I eat daily, what I eat every day, is going to make a difference in my day. I mean, whether it's something light or something heavy, something good for you, something not so good for you. Specifically with the lupus, because you have a lot of joint pain, you know, you want to avoid as much salt as possible. You know, I think there's an old adage a long time ago that said that you are whatever you eat, and everybody kind of laughed about it. But the truth is, it's so true. You know, if you are eating fast food all day long, if that is your diet, then you are going to feel really, you're going to start dragging. After a while, it takes its toll on you, you know, not eating what's the best thing for you. We eat a lot
mm-hmm.
of raw vegetables, and we try to cut back a lot on the meat, you know, and it's because you just realize that it has this effect on you. And then when you start eating better, you don't even think about the other food. I don't even think about soda anymore. It just doesn't occur to me to even pick one up anymore, you know, because soda never quenches your thirst. You're always thirsty. You're always wanting more. And that's why people consume so much soda, because they try to quench
mm-hmm.
their thirst with soda, and they're just going to want
mm-hmm.
more, you know,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to water. You know, so, yeah, it's very important to be conscientious about what you're eating, you know, because
mm-hmm.
a lot of people, I'm one of them, it's comfort food. It's comfort
mm-hmm.
food. You know, like the people that eat popcorn when they watch the TV at night or watching a movie, you know, these are comfort foods. And
mm-hmm.
It can either contribute to good health or contribute to bad health. But either
mm-hmm.
way, it's going to contribute to your day.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to have a great day or a bad day. Even if the thing you're fixing isn't necessarily the best thing for you, if you're doing it every once in a while, you know, it can make you, it can change your day. If I fix lasagna, even though I know I'm really not supposed to be eating the noodles and everything, if I fix it and I'm able to eat some of it, I feel great. I'll feel great because I feel it's the love of making it and making it for you and your family, and it's a great thing.
You know, you can always use gluten-free noodles, and gluten especially. You know, we've discovered that gluten is really bad for a lot of people. And so
right.
I have a lot of clients that, and a lot of friends now, that are, I'm off gluten. I can eat a little bit of it. I'm not celiac. I don't have that problem. But the studies have shown that this gluten is totally different than what we grew up with because of the genetically modified foods and how they've
right.
changed wheat and corn. And so I don't
mm-hmm.
eat it. I can eat a burrito once in a while, and I can have a corn tortilla because we have great Mexican food out here. And
right.
I love a chili rellenos, you know, I love that. It's like, oh, the best crispy chili, but I don't eat it, you know, that's that's a treat. You know, I made that once every 3 or 4 months. I may have one. And but yeah, I think it's a multifaceted approach. And I think I listen and I pray about what I write, and I'm very intentional, and I think healing is intentional. And I think
right.
if you know what's wrong with your body and then learn to listen, what is my body telling me? What is my body mm-hmm. saying? And when we realize that, we can stop and say, well, what do I need to be doing? And there's many books that discuss symptoms. So if you have a symptom, what is that saying? Like if you have back pain or you have stomach, you have problems with your stomach, you're not digesting things, what is that saying about your life? Are you leading
right.
a twist? Are you drinking too much coffee?
Right.
Are you drinking Red Bull? If you're not sleeping, what are you consuming during the day, either at work with the emotional stress? And certainly, being in the military can be extraordinarily stressful. So what ways do you use to calm yourself and come into that place of balance? And you and I have already talked about a couple of them.
Mm-hmm.
But I think everybody's different. Some people can run or take a walk, or they can go out for a bike ride, or here in Colorado we can snowshoe or ski, or some people love to swim. And so every physical body has its own set. For me, I love swimming. I love swimming too. I'm a swimmer.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I get into the water, I'm like, oh, this is heaven. So those are some things that I think are really important, you know, to learn how. And sometimes when we're in stressful situations, we don't realize, wow, you know, I'm really stressed. So having a book that I hope that my book will touch that place, that mm-hmm. people can look at and go, wow, these are some simple things. And also a lot of military bases are very isolated. So I'm going to put references in there to let them know how they can get these and order things online that they mm-hmm. might want to look at.
Right.
And I also want to say one thing that's really important about healing. Do you know who Dave Pelzer is? Have you ever read any of his work? Dave Pelzer, P-E-L-Z-E-R?
It sounds familiar. I'm not sure.
Okay. Well, he had some childhood trauma. And so he wrote about his journey, and he actually became a therapist. And he was very traumatized by an alcoholic mother, and he almost died because he was pretty abused, very severely, I would say pretty, was very severely abused. And he overcame that. And one of the things that was the final step for him, and I know that you know this, but it's very important in healing, is we have to really learn that people make mistakes, that not everybody is a wonderful person to be around. Unfortunately, that's the way of the world, but it's the truth. And so we have to learn to forgive, that you don't know what that person at work or that girlfriend that you dated, or, you know, you got involved with someone and they didn't turn out to be great. Their trauma led to them being that way, and they haven't healed from that. And often we think, oh, well, they were mistreating me because, you know, it's my fault or I did something. But often people act out of what they don't know. And Dave Pelzer writes about making the choice to forgive that person. And he forgives his mother. His mother was the abuser. And so when you can look at whatever happened to you, whether it's being in the military or it's being traumatized in a marriage or a divorce or at work or a bad accident, if you can forgive and really understand that, you know, there are bad things that happen in life, if you can forgive, and that will really help your healing process.
I think that's huge, because when you hold on to that negative connotation of the experience, and you
and you are unable to release it, that it literally drags you down. It can literally drag you down because you're carrying that. It's like carrying a bag of bricks wherever you go. You know, you after a while, you think you're okay at first. It's not that heavy. But after you're carrying it around for a month, a year, 2 years, 3 years, it wears down on you. And it literally makes it almost impossible for you to move, you know, because it bogs you down. It's almost like a slow suffocation.
It is.
You know, and often people will say, well, you know, they don't deserve forgiveness. It's not about them. It's about you. Because as long as you are unwilling to forgive it, you're unwilling to let go of it. You know, because you have to hold on to that feeling. You have to hold on to the fact that they did you this huge injustice. And a lot of the time, it is huge. You know, not to discount not to discount what happened to them at all. You know, a lot of the time, it is so big that you don't even notice the elephant in the room anymore because you've been carrying it around for so long. But other people will say to you, you know, what is it about life that makes you unhappy all the time or unable to smile or unable to enjoy even a beautiful day, whether it's the first snow or the, you know, the hottest day of the year? What is it about you in your life that is unwilling to connect to even the beauty that is granted to you just by waking up today? You know, so it's important.
Totally agree, and I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I was just going to say that when I was in Hawaii, one of my commanders said to me his favorite saying, and I was doing a presentation for him, and he said one of his favorite sayings was, "Don't let anyone steal your joy." And so I use that in my, and I love that, and that's actually biblical. It's in I think it's in John, and I love that. Do not let anything or anyone, because you have control over that.
Exactly.
You know, you have control over, and if it's a bad day, get up and go, wow, you know, today's not a great day, but I'm going to get through it, and tomorrow is going to be a better day. And very successful people know that. I mean, there's a lot of people that have overcome great tragedy. There's a man, and I read his book, and I just forgot his name. And he was born with, you probably know what I'm talking about, he was born with no arms and no legs. And he has a tiny little foot.
That's what you're talking about.
I can't think of his name.
And I can't either.
It's amazing because he's been skydiving, and he's a motivational speaker, and he has the biggest positive attitude. And I read his book, and I was like, oh, my God. This man, and he got married. He married a beautiful woman, and they're gonna have a child. And I'm like, he says, nothing in this world is too great for me to accomplish. I can do it. I skydive. He's been on a surfboard in Hawaii surfing, and he says, you can do anything. You have to find your own way, but you can do it. And he's amazing. I'm like, you know, if he can do that with no arms and not feel any resentment over being born that way.
I think his name Nick Vucic. His name is Nick Vucic, I think.
Okay, thank you. It is, Nick Vucic. Uh-huh.
Yeah, I think his book is called No Arms, No Legs, No Worries.
There you go.
You know, he's amazing. I talked about him a lot because I've watched some videos where he's been a motivational speaker to children. You know, and you'll see, I mean, he's great. He is great. You know, to never let anyone tell you can't, that you aren't good enough, that you cannot do it. Don't let anything ever stop you. And, you know, I'm always in tears when I'm listening to him because I'm thinking to myself, if he doesn't let anything stop him, no one has any room to say, I just can't. You know, it's just, he's amazing. He really, really is amazing.
And, you know, I know we're about out of time, and I want to say that's the hope, because there are complementary integrative remedies that not only that I'm putting in my new book, Healing the Heart of a Warrior, and I'm putting that in there for the sole purpose of it being a tool. It's a toolbox for our men and women who've served, for the wives, for the girlfriends, extended family, and that is a tool to have the hope that you can find answers, that if you go to one person and they don't have an answer, keep looking, because not always is it a straight line. It's not always linear. And when you're trying to heal something, keep looking. We are in Colorado, and we have many new discoveries being made with all different kinds of things, you know, with the medical marijuana. We've had children now that are with their families are coming here because there's a gentleman in Evergreen, Colorado that developed Charlotte's Web, and it's a remarkable low THC remedy, and they gave it to Charlotte, the first patient, and she could walking and talking and having a normal life where she was having seizures. And the medical community, pharmaceuticals, could not touch her. She could not speak or walk or communicate. Mm-hmm. And they brought her to Colorado, gave her this very low, it almost has no THC in it, so there's no high. Mm-hmm. And now 500 families are bringing their children here to live in Colorado to treat their children.
That's amazing.
And who would have known that? 5 years ago, we didn't know that would happen.
Right.
It just happened. And so new things are being discovered, and you never, never, ever give up the hope and the love and the joy of finding that new path in life.
Exactly.
And I wish that for anyone who's listening. That's my desire, and I hope that whatever we've said tonight touches the hearts of your community and your listeners. And it's a pleasure and honor to be here.
Thank you so much.
I'm so grateful.
I really appreciate you coming on the show with me tonight. How can people get a hold of you if they want to? Facebook, Twitter?
I'm on my Facebook page is Healing the Heart of a Warrior, or just Facebook Joyce Graham, and I'm in Denver. My website is joycegraham.com, and my email address is just joyce@joycegraham.com, and I always answer all my emails. And if they like a copy, autographed copy of either one of my books that are already out, I'm happy to do that through my website. They can order a book, and I mail them out personally. So thank you so much for this great conversation, and I'm happy to help you in any way I can with your work, and I know you're doing a great job with this radio show. It's wonderful. You're a wonderful host.
Thank you so much. Again, I really appreciate you being on the show with me tonight. It's really meant a lot to me. Definitely, I would encourage anyone to contact Joyce Graham. She does return the emails. She returned mine. I really am so grateful for it. And we'll be back a moment with my rays of light.
Skies are crying, I'm watching, catching teardrops in my hands, only silence. We never had a chance.
Hi, I am Capri Smith, your uncuffed living expert. I am also a transformational and empowering business coach. I teach strong, empowered women how to uncover their own life's purpose and match it with a business of their dreams and create several streams of income. I believe if you're not living uncuffed, you're just not living. There are too many women that are faking it until they make it. Working with me enables you to do the self-work so that you live the life that's meant for you. I invite you to visit CapriSmith.com. There you will find my packages. I conduct VIP days where I spend an entire day working one-to-one with my client. I also host monthly seminars. I have a huge annual seminar, and I founded my nonprofit 501c3, where we teach families and teens about dating and domestic violence. There are so many layers to me. I invite you to connect by visiting CapriSmith.com and scheduling your free 20-minute strategy session where you too can start to live uncuffed. In addition, every Saturday at 10 o'clock, I invite my listeners to the May We Help You radio team, where they hear from other women who, like me, have discovered their purpose and are living the life that's meant for them. Until I meet you in person, have a wonderful day. And remember, if you're not living uncuffed, you're just not living.
Welcome back to the My Rays of Light show. I'm your host, Ellen Young. I wanted to thank Joyce Graham for joining us tonight because she had a lot of really valuable information, and I would encourage each and every one of you to contact her if you're interested in getting one of her books, because she has a huge insight from a large spectrum of places, you know, and healing is very important. Even if you haven't been through something as serious as a war, we all do have our own wars that we're fighting, and any small insight might be able to help us. I wanted to thank May We Help You Radio Network for providing this platform that we use to be able to connect. And I want to thank our sponsors, Santress Magazine, Sherry Cofield International, and Coach Capri Smith. Someone wise told me that only your mind tells you to keep up the pointless fight. Your mind will tell you that you must win. The victory is the last one standing. But your soul, your core, that thing that keeps you connected to our Creator, will tell you that the most important thing is to survive. It is in our survival where hope will thrive. I found my grandmother's words to be soothing to me, even in her absence. Her soft, melodic tone reminded me that victory may be sweet, but like a piece of candy, the feeling is temporary, and the reward of patience are boundless. I can recall thinking that I understood what survival actually meant. Then she asked me, "What is survival?" I responded proudly, "It means I win." She smiled and said, "But what have you won?" She would go on to say, "There is no victory in the destruction of others. Survival is about the person you evolve into when true adversity finds us." We often find ourselves in conversations where we feel like we must be right, because to be right is to win. But what do we win? We elevate our blood pressure. Often we are mean and cruel to others, or them to us. What is the prize in which we seek? What is the prize we're looking for? And more importantly, what does it cost us? The price of cruelty can be a bottomless pit. I think we've all had that dream. We are dropped into a giant hole. It is cold and wet, darkness is all around us. This can be the price when we slaughter the hopes and dreams of others. It took me a long time and many losses in my life to finally try and understand what the lesson of my life was trying to teach me. I would be standing alone in a crowd, searching for the knowledge I had the whole time. Surviving did not mean someone else lost. Surviving meant putting my soul before my pride. It meant searching for God and finding that He lived inside of me the whole time. It meant treading more softly on the hearts of others. Because trampling on someone's dreams and aspirations showed nothing about them, but showed everyone exactly who we are. You know, that person that we are when no one's watching, the dark wolf, the part of us that is grim and stagnant. We get so trapped within our own neediness that we forget the true purpose of our existence. Are we so busy worrying about what another person may do to you that you fail to love? Do you feel justified based on some past experience, real or imagined? We do not have the right to destroy the heart of others. And when we do, we have become the very energy that had crushed our hopes and dreams. We, in fact, have devolved. We start walking in place, and when we pick up the pace and start running, we wonder why nothing has changed. Nothing has changed because you have gone nowhere. The first step is always the hardest, but it must be taken. Release the ties that bind us to indifference, hate, or the bad memories of such. It is a memory. Acknowledge it and let it go. It happened. It was supposed to. It made you stronger. Don't allow it to make you bitter. You are a survivor, and if so, what did you survive? What will you do with the blessing of your first breath in the morning? Will you pass on the gifts of gratitude and humility, or will you be proud and boastful? Make the most of your moments. They are brief and can leave your footprints on the hearts of many. Be the light and love of forgiveness. It is a gift that we will all be in need of ourselves. It's important that we know that we, just like Joyce told us earlier, we are in control. We are in control of every situation that we embrace, that we hold up, that we enforce. Any energy that comes through you comes because you open the door for it. Nothing can come through you that you don't allow. Every day you might have to sort out what's going on. What did you experience? Who did you talk to? What were you talking about? What did you watch? What did you read? And what is it doing to you? Because everything that comes through us, we grab the energy. It becomes a part of who we are. So daily, I will have to reevaluate my day. Why do I feel tired today? Why do I feel mad today? Why do I feel angry today? For no apparent reason. And the reasoning is because I am now carrying the energy of someone or something else that was angry. You carry it around. It's like a coat, and you keep piling these coats on top of you. Like I mentioned earlier with a bag of bricks. At first, it seems like it's not that heavy. It's just a bag of bricks. But after you're carrying it around for 24 hours, it's going to get a little heavy, and it's going to cause you to be short with others. Have you ever been running for long distances, and then someone after a run will say, "Let's go shopping. Let's go to the mall." When you would usually say, "Yes, let's go. Let me get on my shoes. Let's go get in the car. Let's go." But after you run, 3-5 miles, you may not feel like doing that, and you're going to be shorter with them. It's the same thing that happens when you're carrying around the energy of frustration and anger. It exhausts you. You feel like, "I cannot hear another word right now. I don't want to hear another word." And in this life, we can't afford to be that way. because a lot of the time what happens is the people that we're pushing away are our children, are our loved ones, are the ones that we love the most and the ones that love us deeply. You know, and those are the people that we're pushing away. Those are the ones that, those are the hearts we are breaking. Whenever you push your child away because you have had a hard day and they want to show you something or read something to you or sing a song to you and you are telling them how tired you are exhausted, what kind of day you have had, you are breaking the heart of someone who is depending on you to make them feel better. We must always take this into consideration. We must take this into consideration. Earlier tonight, we were talking about hope. Hope must exist if change is going to happen. It must exist. When we were talking earlier about Nick Busick. He has no arms and no legs. And he's a constant reminder of that, of the fact that if you have hope, you have everything. He has no arms and no legs. There should be no reason why he's smiling and happy. I know most people, if they are stubbing their toe, their day is done. They're finished. Now, they don't want to hear about light and love. They don't want to hear about anything. Their toe is hurting. This man doesn't have a toe. He's happy. He's happy with his life. He is content. And he wakes up every day feeling blessed that he woke up. If someone with the limitations that he has can wake up and be thankful and hopeful, there is no reason why you or I shouldn't be the exact same way. There's no reason. Hope springs eternal. It exists. And if it exists for you, then you can help it exist for others, because giving back is what we're supposed to do, even if it's only giving a smile. Last year, I wrote a poem called I Will, and I'm going to go ahead and read that to you tonight. I will not give up today, no matter what transpires. My soul will march forward, even when my body begins to tire. I will smile at God's creation, even if it doesn't smile back. I will count all of my blessings while the world tells me what I lack. I will keep on walking forward while there are obstacles in my way. And when man says there is no hope, I will still continue to pray. I will look for the good in all, whilst people acknowledge only the bad. And although you may want me to sit, I will continue making a stand. I will keep erecting bridges where people are torn apart. And even as you may think it's over, I will tell you it's barely start. I will construct a chain of hope, for some may break a link. I will smile and continue on my path before you get a chance to blink. I will smile in adversity while staring at you first. I will sing the praises of our Father and the angels of our midst. I will love always my neighbor while he may swear in my face. You may take my possessions, but never my Creator's grace. I will get back up and start over. Every time I do fall, I will be reminded of the tests which are placed on us all. I will talk about my Father, hallowed be thy name. And while you may try my faith, the outcome is the same. I will ask God for forgiveness. Father, they know not what they do. For while you may cast stones upon me, I will always pray for you. I will continue to spread joy while man displays his hate. I will submit to God's will and pray that before it's too late, that you will see the light, because the darkness tends to hide the beauty you were born from and the love you have inside. I will fail from time to time, as only real people do. but I will never give up on God's will. How about you? I want to thank all of you for joining me tonight. Especially thank my guest, author Joyce Graham. Feel free to contact me on Twitter at LightRays1 or on Facebook. Just search for L.M. Young. Or at my website, www.myraysoflight.com. Until next week, I wish you a week, a life filled with light and love. I am L.M. Young, and these are my rays of light.
A noun meaning a woman with a vision and the heart to follow it. Slantress focuses on inspiring and supporting the growth of Black women, but is open to all women by using this publication as a vehicle that assists in the fostering of aggression. This publication does not speak for every woman, but will work to provide the voices and slant of as many as possible. Get your subscription today at slantress.com. That's slantress.com.
Hi, my name is Letitia M., owner of May We Help You Network. I want to thank you for joining us and enjoying our host here on MWHY Radio Network. please visit us online at mwhyradio.com and like us on facebook.com/mwhyradio. Tune in to learn more about our hosts and upcoming contests and our TV programming that will be coming to you soon. MWHY Radio, bringing together business, community, and youth.